basically just tells Pharaoh, let my people go. And of course, Pharaoh says no, and you all know what happened. What happened when Pharaoh said no? Plagues started coming, right?
Yep.
You have the water turning to blood, you have the lice and all these different things that were happening. And so Pharaoh, he starts making deals with Moses. He starts telling, hey, you can go, you just can't go very far away, or you can go, but you got to leave some of your family behind. You know, you can go, but you got to leave your possessions here. He's making all these deals with Moses, and finally Moses just lays it out for him, and he tells him, hey, if we're going to go, and we're going to go, by the way, but he said, when we go, you're also going to give us sacrifices. He said, we're not going to leave one hoof behind. Now, when Moses said this, though, you might say, well, he's being selfish. You know, why couldn't he just take the deal? I mean, you know, shouldn't they be happy that they're going to be allowed to leave? Shouldn't they just be satisfied with that? I mean, at least he's going to let them take the kids this time. But he said, no, we're taking all our stuff, too.
Amen.
And it wasn't because Moses was just set on having stuff. It wasn't because he was materialistic. Because notice what he says. He says, for thereof must we take to serve the Lord our God, and we know not with what we must serve the Lord until we come thither. You see, when they left Egypt, you all remember, God ended up giving them the Ten Commandments. God ended up giving them the law. God ended up telling them about how, hey, you're going to start doing this sacrifice and that sacrifice. I want you to do all these different things for me. This hasn't happened yet. And so Moses, he knows that when they leave Egypt, that God's going to want something from them. And Moses wanted to make sure whatever God wanted, they had it.
Right.
And so Moses, he's not being selfish here. He's not thinking, we want to keep all the stuff because we just want the stuff. He's saying, no, we want everything because of the simple fact that we don't know what God is going to want from us. And did you know, children, I think you're kind of in a situation similar right now. Y'all are your kids, your teenagers, you're living at home. And really, God's will for your life right now is pretty simple. It's obey your parents, right?
Yep.
I mean, y'all don't have a lot of choices about like where you go to church. You don't have a lot of choices about the rules and things that you live by. They're basically, your parents' law is what you're under right now. You're kind of in bondage, right? Maybe I shouldn't use that term, but you know, it's not. But that's how you feel sometimes, don't you? You often feel that way. And the truth is, when it comes to life and what is coming for you, you all don't, you know, you're not real sure. In fact, some of you probably don't even really think about it that much. You know, I know when I was a teenager, you know, I didn't really worry. I wasn't sitting around worrying about, you know, how am I going to pay all the bills?
Yeah.
You know, most of the time, I just took it for granted that stuff costs money.
Yeah.
That you didn't get to live in a house for free, that food wasn't free. They didn't just let you take the stuff at the grocery stores just because you needed it. I just didn't really think about it. I remember one time, you know, I wanted Dad to buy something. He's like, I don't have enough, you know, I don't have enough money, which to me equaled cash in your wallet. But then I was like, why can't you just write a check?
Yeah.
You know? How many kids have ever said that to your parents? Why don't you just write a check, you know? Now, when you get older, you're going to learn that you got to have something in the checking account, right? You're going to learn that, and you're going to learn what it's going to take to live life and just, you know, be a husband, be a wife, be a parent. And it can be a difficult thing. But in the meantime, right now, it's hard for you to understand what you might need in the future.
Right.
Because most of you probably don't know what God's will is for your life. Even if you've like maybe said, hey, I want to be a preacher or something. You know, you don't know, you know, what all that's going to involve. You know, I've been a pastor for a long time. But even being a pastor, I've had to work other jobs. I've had to do a lot of different things. And, you know, there's been a lot of different challenges that are out there that I never really expected. I had no way of knowing I was going to have to deal with these things as a teenager. And so what I say all that to say this, when it comes to your life right now, you need to have an attitude, I want to hang on to everything I possibly can because I don't know what God is going to want for me in the future. And I want to point out a few of these things because you might not even realize what you have right now.
Right.
There's a lot of things that you kids have that a lot of adults have already lost.
Yep.
That they didn't even realize they had.
Right.
And now they look back and it's like, you know, I wish I hadn't given that up. You know, if I hadn't given that up, I could have had it to use for the Lord,
right.
And my adult life would have been a whole lot better, but they didn't realize they had it. Most kids, they throw these things away, not realizing the value of them. They're kind of like Esau, who sold his birthright for just one morsel of bread meal. Just one morsel of meat, that's all it was, and he threw away his birthright, and you know what? He regretted it.
Right.
And he wanted it back. And he sought it carefully. I mean, he repented greatly. He was even crying about it, but it was too late. And a lot of adults are out there today. They regret giving up the things that some of you all have. Things that are of great value. Things that are worth more than large amounts of money. Things more worth more than all the money in the world. They've given them up. And some of y'all don't even realize you have them. And I want to point these things out to you to make sure you realize what you've got. And then hang on to it.
Amen.
And because some of y'all too, you've probably heard you have some of these things before, but a lot of times I don't need it because that's not my plan for the future.
Right.
But wait a minute, what about God's plan for the future?
Right.
Have you thought about that? Because God's plan for your life is actually what will make you the happiest.
Right.
That is where, you know, God has made you for something.
Amen.
God has something out there designed perfectly for you. And it might not be what you're thinking right now. Some of you all think, you know, I want to be a rock star or something, okay? You know, you've been fooled by that. But truth is, that's not going to make you happy.
Right.
Truth is, you probably don't even have what it takes to do that. And you're going to go throwing away what God has given you so you can pursue something that's just a false dream, that's a lie. And you don't want to do that. So first thing that you don't want to give up is make sure you don't let go of God's best for your life.
Amen.
Because God has a plan for you. God told Jeremiah, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee.
Right.
God had ordained him. God had a choice for him before he was even conceived. God had a purpose for Jeremiah. God had something for him. And you know what? God has something for all of you out there too. There's something out there that God has made you for, that you've been designed for. There is a woman for all you guys out there that God has raised up and designed for you.
Right.
You want to find her. Same thing for you girls. There's a guy out there that God has raised up and designed for you, and you want him.
Yeah.
Hey, that's what you're looking for, and you don't want to let go of that.
Right.
You need to understand there are things that we can lose. We can lose God's best for our life.
Right.
The Bible says, he that being oft reproved and hardeneth his neck shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy.
Right.
There's some things we can't fix. There's just some things that we can't undo. And so we've got to watch out for that. And so you know what? You need to, you know, one thing you need to determine you're going to do, kids, is keep yourself pure so you can have God's best when it comes to finding a spouse.
Amen.
You just need to determine that. You know what? You kids right now, you're getting to that age where if you're not careful, you're going to start getting hit with a lot of temptations from this world. If you're watching stuff on television, if you're out there on the internet, if you go to a public school and you hang around worldly friends, they're going to be telling you, you need to experiment with a lot of stuff that's going to take away something very valuable, and that's your purity.
Amen.
That's something that you need to hang on to because you want to have God's best for your life.
Right.
You want to have the best family possible. But some of you out there, you know, when you're young, you just have this attitude, I don't even know if I ever want to get married.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm just going to do whatever. But wait a minute. What if God wants you to get married?
Amen.
Yeah.
Right.
Yep. You know, what if God, you know, some girl, I'm never going to have kids. Wait a minute. What if God wants you to have kids?
Right.
What if that's God's best for you? What if that's God's plan for your life?
Amen.
Are you sure you want to do something to hurt that, to throw that away? Are you sure you want to do something that's going to kill your chances of getting that good spouse? Because I'm going to tell you right now, if you go around and you're messing around and you're getting involved in the sin and the filth, this goes on in this world, you know what? Godly people aren't going to want you.
Right.
Yep.
And you say, that's a terrible attitude, but you know what? I think it's okay for those who've remained pure to want somebody who has remained pure also.
Right.
I think that's okay.
Yeah.
Oh, well, it was a mistake. Well, you know, it was a big mistake.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, you threw something away
that
was of great value, and you need to realize it, and you might think, well, I don't really care about it for myself. But you know what? Care about it for God.
Amen.
Because I know He wants you to keep that until you get married. That's God's will. You need to keep yourself holy so you can have God's best when it comes to the calling in your life.
Amen.
Listen, if you're getting caught up in different sins, those things are going to corrupt you. They're going to hurt you. God wants to use a clean vessel. And if you're out there and you're watching filth and you're getting involved in all this sin and just getting your mind messed up and distorted from the things of this world, you know what? God's not going to be able to use you in the same way. Yeah. God can still use you. Even if you mess up, I don't want you to think that God can never use you.
Right.
God can still use somebody that messes up big time, but you know, not in the same way.
Yeah.
And not in the best way. Not in the best way that he could have. You know, you need to keep yourself blameless. With the loss, you can have better opportunities.
Yep.
Okay, so, for example, yeah, I remember I talked to a guy one time. This guy, we were out knocking doors. This was when I was at my dad's church. And, you know, he was just real, you know, broken when I talked to him, sincere and everything. And talking about how he needs help. And, you know, the guy got saved. But, you know, the guy, and the guy needed salvation because he needs to go to heaven, right?
Right.
Yeah.
But this guy also had another problem, and that is, he had a major criminal record, and because of this criminal record, he just couldn't get a job anywhere.
No.
Because he couldn't get a job, he could not pay his bills, and he was about to get thrown out of his house.
No.
He also had a girlfriend. He also had kids with that girlfriend, and he's there telling me about all these financial problems he has. He owes all these people money. He owes all this rent, and this guy's like crying about it. He's upset, and I'm thinking, man, I'd love to help this guy, but I didn't have the money that this guy needed
right.
to get any help.
Yep.
And I remember just thinking, you know, I felt helpless as I walked away from that guy because it's like, I didn't give this guy any physical help at all. I didn't have the ability to do it. But at the same time, too, I just remember thinking, you know what, that guy never should have broke those laws.
Right.
That guy never should have taken those drugs and sold those drugs.
Right.
That guy never should have shacked up with that girl and got her pregnant.
Right.
That guy shouldn't have went and spent all of
right.
his money on alcohol and tobacco and all
right.
these other things
yep.
where he can't pay his bills. I'm like, this guy has just made a lifetime of
right.
mistakes and then just wants me to come along and write a check and fix it. I can't do that.
Right. Right.
And you know, there a lot of you young people, all right, you young men especially, most of y'all, you know, if you're especially if you're not even 16 yet, and even if you are 16, a lot of times you don't think that much about getting a job. Because again, you just think, you know, food is just something your parents just go get from the grocery stores when they need it.
Yeah.
Right? Not realizing, no, your parents actually work really hard for the money that pays for that.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of young people out there, they're not thinking about the fact that, you know, one of these days, I'm going to want to have my own house. One of these days, I'm going to want to have a nice car that I can drive. And I'm going to want to have the ability to do what I want to do and to be able to travel where I want to travel. You know, I'm thankful we're able to travel
yeah.
in this country. I'm thankful I can leave our state whenever I want. I wanted to leave it a lot lately because of all the restrictions we have going on. But, you know, actually ours is getting better than y'all's.
Yeah.
But anyway, it's another subject. But did you know that, young men, there are certain laws, if you break them, you know you won't be able to get a good job because of that.
Right.
You know, you're going to have to fill out an application one of these days, and you're going to have to put if you have any criminal history on there.
Yep.
And did you know you may get overlooked? Not because you're not capable of doing that job, because of a mistake that you made in your past. You say, well, I don't think that's right. Well, welcome to the United States. That's the way it is.
Right.
And you're not going to be able to get a job because of that. And all of a sudden, now you're going to find yourself in a difficult position. You might want to go and you know, get a house or rent a house. You're going to have to fill out an application for that. And because you're not making very good money, you're not going to be able to get the house that you wanted. You know, you're not going to be able to do a lot of things. Some of you, if you get certain things on your record too, you're not allowed to leave the state.
No.
There's some people, they can't leave the state. They can't do hardly anything without calling up their parole officer and asking them if they can leave the state.
No.
And they got to get permission. Can you imagine? I can't even imagine as a grown man having to ask permission to leave the state.
No.
But you know, there are a lot of young men out there today that's their life. You know why? Because they decided to get involved in drugs.
Right.
Right.
Not even thinking about what this was going to do to their future. And you know, and a lot of people too who have done those things have since got right with God.
Yep.
Since they've gotten right with God. They love the Lord. They're not doing those things anymore, but yet they just have no opportunities out there just because of that record. They can't get rid of it. It won't go away. You know, there's some things that you do. You know, you go messing around, you giving into the lust of your flesh, you can get put on sex offender lists and things that will haunt you for the rest of your life.
Yep.
People won't want to live by you.
Right.
Nobody's going to want to have anything to do with you because of something that you have on your record. And listen, God doesn't want that.
Yeah.
for you.
Right.
God's got something better for you. But a lot of young people, they're not thinking, what might God want from me in the future? They're just thinking, what do I want for myself right now?
Yeah.
And some of you, you might think, well, you know what? I'm willing to sacrifice that, the chances of that good family in the future, because I just don't really care about that. I just want this little bit of fun right now. But wait a minute. God wants you to have that good family in the future. God wants you to have that potential. And so you need to keep yourself from evil. That way you don't bring a curse on your life. I like what it says in Joshua 6:18. Says that ye in any wise keep yourselves from the accursed thing, lest ye make yourselves accursed when ye take of the accursed thing and make the camp of Israel accursed and trouble it.
Right.
And if you go on and read the next chapter, that's exactly what happened. A man named Achan went and took of the accursed thing and brought a curse on Israel and on himself and on his family. His eyes got real big when he saw some good things, some nice things, but they were things God told him he couldn't have, and he took them, and he ruined his life and his family's lives. And there's a lot of things out there that some of y'all are going to be tempted with. There's going to be a guy or a girl out there that you're going to be tempted with that is not God's will.
Right.
That your flesh says at once, you've got to say no.
Right.
It will ruin your life. There's going to be, you know, opportunities. People are going to try to tempt you to look at things or maybe to try some things. You got to say no. We were just singing the song, "My son is enticed thee, consent thou not." You better drill that song in your head.
Amen.
You better get that verse memorized, not just good enough to repeat back so you get it marked up on your paper, but so you'll remember it, so it'll be in your heart. And the next time somebody comes along and tries to entice you with something, you know what? You're not going to consent to that. You're going to say no to that. You're going to shut it down.
Amen.
You know why? Because you're thinking about your future.
Right.
Yeah, but right now I want the popularity. I want people to think I'm cool. I want people to like me. I get that, but you know what? Be like Moses and think about what God's going to want for you in the future, because you don't know what it is.
Nope.
You don't know what it is, and that's why you need it. And so you need to make sure you don't let go of these things. Don't let go of your purity. Don't listen. Most of you in here probably have a spotless criminal record. Hang on to that.
Amen.
That's a wonderful thing. Hang on to that. That's a good thing. Most of you in here, hopefully you can all say, you know what? I've never smoked. I've never drank. I've never done drugs. Hang on to that.
Amen.
Yep.
Amen.
You say, I'm the only one of my friends that's never tried this stuff.
Yep.
You know what? 10 years from now, you'll be able to brag about how I'm the only one of my friends that's not done that stuff.
Yeah.
And I'm also the only one of my friends that's not been to jail.
Yeah.
I'm also the only one of my friends that's got a happy family that's only been married one time.
Yeah.
You know, that's the things you're going to be able to say in the future. You might not be able, instead, you might not look cool now, but you will in the future.
Amen.
You will in the future. That's what you've got to be thinking about. That's what you've got to get in your mind. So hang on to what you have, but also try to get as much as you can.
Right.
Hey, try to get as much as you can. For example, and I hate to bring this up in summer, but you know you ought to try to get as much as you can from school.
Yeah. Amen.
Yeah, I hate to use that word in the summer. I know that's a cuss word in the summertime, but you know I think it needs to be mentioned. But you know, one thing I hear kids say all the time, and I said this all the time too growing up, why do I got to learn all this stuff in math?
Yeah.
I'm never going to use it. But wait a minute. Wait a minute. What if God wants you to be a math teacher?
Yeah.
Come on now.
I mean, most kids would rather spend all their time in the video games and watching television than, you know, doing homework and studying and actually learning something.
No.
Okay, but you say, well, I have no intention of being a math teacher, but God might want you to be.
Amen.
Yeah.
So unless you feel like the Lord's leading you to be a movie critic or a video game video gamer for life, and I highly doubt He's going to do that.
Amen.
You know, I think you should probably focus on these things because God might want it from you.
Right.
I hate history. God might want you to be a history teacher.
Right.
You know, who knows? I don't like English, but God might want you to write books someday.
Amen.
Yep.
You don't know. So what your attitude ought to be is like, you know what? If I want God to use me, it's going to help if there's something there for Him to use.
Right. Amen.
So the more I can get, the more I can gain, the more I can learn, the more it's going to help. You know, I'm thankful for some of the people we have in our church that have special talents that can be used. For example, you know, we've got people in our church that speak Spanish.
Yeah.
And you know, we're thinking about starting some kind of Spanish ministry. Guess who's going to get used for that?
Yeah.
People that know Spanish.
Right.
And God's not going to use me for that. I don't know any other language. I barely know English. So God's not going to use me for that. But you know what? These people can be used.
Right.
for that. Thankfully, they learned that. That's why it's good to learn another language.
Amen.
You learn something like that, that's just one more thing that God could use you. That's one more area. That's one more part of the world where
right.
you can be used of God where other people can't.
Right.
So you ought to just be like, you know, I'm going to give whatever I can from this. You know, you might, if you, maybe the Lord's gifted you with brains and you're smart. Did you know if you're really smart, you might be able to make a lot of money.
Yep.
And you might be able to use that money for the Lord. So I don't need to make a lot of money. But God might need you to.
Amen.
God might want you. Because God might want to be able to use you to fund different projects and things.
Right.
You know, I guarantee every pastor would admit they'd love to have more rich people in their church.
Right.
As long as they would just give and shut up. Instead of, you know, using their giving to try to run the church.
Yeah.
But at the same time, you know, you don't know what God is going to ask of you once you get out of your house. So you ought to be trying to get everything you can. That was Moses' attitude. He's like, we don't know what God's going to want. So you ought to try to do that. You know, you ought to have the attitude, I want to be somebody that God can use for anything. So I'm going to just get as many skills as I can. I'm going to get as much knowledge as I can. And since some jobs come with certain requirements.
Right.
Go ahead and turn over to 1 Timothy chapter 3. All right, let me show you something here in 1 Timothy chapter 3. Now right here, this is the requirements for the office of a bishop or a deacon. Okay? So young men here, you might think, oh, I don't want to be a pastor or a deacon. But God might want you to.
Amen.
You don't know that. Don't go. I've had people say it before. I'm not really worried about those things because I have no intention of ever being a pastor.
Yeah.
It's not. It shouldn't be your choice.
Right.
It's
Amen.
God's choice
Amen.
On that. And he says, if a man desire the office of a bishop, he desireth a good work. This is a good work. But you know what? Not everybody can do it. So he says, a bishop then must be blameless. The husband of one wife. Vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach, not given to wine. No striker, no greedy or filthy lucre, but patient, not a brawler, nor covetous. He's naming all these things here. Because these wouldn't be, if you're going to be a pastor and you've got problems in these areas, you're not going to do a good job being a pastor.
Right.
Yep. It says, one that ruleth well his own house, having his children in subjection with all gravity. For if a man know not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God? Did you know that if you want to rule your own house well, it's going to help a lot if you have a good wife?
Right.
Yep.
So maybe you ought to do everything you can to make sure you get a good wife.
Yep.
Because there's a lot of these things we see in here too. If your wife doesn't fit the mold, then you're not going to either.
Right.
So you want, you know, and so ladies, you ought to try to be the kind of woman that can help a man like this.
Right.
And that can raise good kids. You know, that ought to be your attitude. One that does these things, that you know, you're doing these things yourself too. It says, not a novice, lest being lifted up with pride, he fall into the condemnation of the devil. And if you're going to be a pastor, you can't be a novice. You need to have some kind of experience in leading. So you know what you ought to be trying to do, even now as young people, trying to get involved wherever you can in the church.
Amen.
Yep.
Amen.
You know what? You ought to get some experience preaching. Now, the pastor's probably not going to let you get up and preach every week. But you know what? He might let you preach in a Sunday school class or to the bus kids or to a nursing home.
Yeah.
Get as much time in as you can.
Right.
Yeah.
Because God might want that for you in the future. Yeah. And did you know, even if God never has you be a pastor, did you know there's no pastor out there that wouldn't love to have more men in his church as capable of filling the pulpit?
Right.
Yeah.
That's a huge blessing. So if you get some practice in that area, if you get some experience in that area, that's just more areas where you're going to be able to be used of God and to be a blessing in the church. You have no idea just the little things that can be such a huge blessing in a church. I'm thankful for people in our church that know how to do things like electrical work.
Man.
You know how much money that saved our church? Yep. Some of the people just using their talents in our church. You know, there's people in our church. There's a man in my church. He's a good mechanic. And you know, while he doesn't have a lot of money he could just give me, he's always fixing stuff on my vehicle. That saved me thousands of dollars.
Amen.
I'm thankful for that. You know, God's using him in that way. You just learning how to do something like that. You learning how to fix a car, you know, can save you a lot of money. You can save somebody else a lot of money. You might be able to fix a church bus or something like that. There's so many ways you can be used. And the truth is, this age that you're at right now, this is the time to be just learning, increasing, you know, your skills and all that. Because when you get older and you have a wife and kids, you're just so busy just trying to provide and survive sometimes. It's hard to get any extra.
Right.
But you can be doing all that right now. So you need to get as much as you can And we're not going to go through all this, but he goes on in these two talking about the requirements of a deacon. It's like, here's some things for a deacon, and I'm just here to tell you, you don't know what God's going to want. God might want you to be a missionary someday. And so if you have some kind of opportunity to learn a foreign language or something that could be beneficial in that area, just do it.
Good.
Don't think, I'd rather spend my time playing video games. I'm just not going to do that. No, that shouldn't be your attitude.
Right.
Your attitude needs to be, I don't know what God's going to want me to do, so I'm going to learn everything I can. You know, and learn as many skills as you can. You might think, well, I want, you know, this is the area I want to go in my life. You know, I want to be in this business, you know. But imagine if that would have been the guy's attitude, you know, 20 years ago who wanted to be, you know, a phone booth installer.
Yeah.
What do you think that guy's doing now? You know? Or a typewriter salesman. Or a typewriter. You know, what do you think that, how do you think that guy's business is going? You know, some of the things that you want to do, they might be gone.
Yeah.
10, 20 years from now. So, you know, you just need to learn everything you can, get as much as you can. Because some jobs come with certain requirements. There's some jobs out there, you know, we all want the job that pays really good. But, you know, some jobs require a certain level of education, some kind of experience. There's a lot of things, so you need to be trying to do whatever you can do there. You need to get as much wisdom as you can during this time. You need to be trying to learn from your parents, from your pastor, from other spiritual leaders. Proverbs 19:26 says, "He that wasteth his father and chaseth away his mother is a son that causeth shame and bringeth reproach."
Yeah.
You know, your parents have some things that they need to teach you.
Right.
And I know they try, but you know it's hard to teach somebody something when they don't want to learn it.
Yeah.
Come on now.
So you need to realize that those parents that God gave you, they've got some things for you that you need to learn. There's some wisdom that you need to try to gain, and you need to make sure you get it.
Right.
So you know what that means? It means you're going to take the time to listen to what they've got to say. You're going to take the time to watch. You need to, girls, you need to take time to talk to your mom and watch what your mom does when it comes to taking care of a household, taking care of kids, and try to help and do what you can in that area. I'm thankful for my daughters that know how to make meals and do all kinds of things. And it's to the point now I can let my wife go away for a week and our house not just completely fall apart, me not completely starve to death, because you know our girls know how to do things.
Yeah.
And you know, it's a blessing. Okay, now what do they get out of it right now? Well, maybe not a whole lot, but you know what? One of these days, they're gonna make a great candidate for some guy's wife.
Yeah.
And they have a better chance of getting a good guy, and which is gonna make them happier and to be able to actually have a happy home. So these are important things. You need to get all you can. There's going to come a day, too, when your parents are going to be around. You're going to need their wisdom. If your grandparents are still around, you know, talk to them. Learn from them. Get something from it. They're not always going to be there. My grandpa, my last grandparent, you know, just died less than 2 years ago. I don't have any grandparents left that I can talk to anymore. I was thinking about that the other day, and it's just weird, you know, thinking about that. But I'm just, that's what happens when you get older.
Right.
One of these days, my parents won't be around.
Yep.
You know, I'm not looking forward to that, but that time's going to come for all of us, so you better make sure you pick up a few things.
Right.
And let me tell you, I'm thankful, you know, for all the things that, you know, I've gotten from my dad, who was a pastor, that I've used in my church. You know, used raising my kids.
Right.
It's a little trick I learned from my dad.
Yep.
It's a little something I picked up from him, something that worked. You need to pay attention. So many young people today are just doing everything they can to distance themselves, get away from their parents, thinking, if I just need to turn 18, get out of the house, then I can do what I want. But you can't have that attitude. You need to be thinking, I don't know what God wants.
Right.
And since you don't know what God wants, you better hang on to everything you've got. You better grab hold of everything you can. And you need to be waiting for that day when God gives you those instructions.
Right.
And you know, when the time came when God gave Israel those instructions, they were ready to go.
Right.
Yeah. They had everything that was needed so they could do those sacrifices and do what was required of a holy God. So, you know, we need to be spending as much time as we can involved in the house of God.
Yep.
You know, thank God for days like this. I remember one of the hardest things for me when I got out of high school and I got a full-time job is the first time, you know, the youth and the teens all went somewhere. and I wasn't able to go. Right. I'll never forget it. I was working at a Menards at the guard shack where they check all the stuff coming in, and it was right by an interstate ramp. And I remember they were that day they were going to be leaving, going to one of my favorite things that we went go to every year. And I remember sitting in that guard check as they rode down that ramp on the bus honking the horn at me. And I remember just sitting there thinking, I'm an adult. This stinks. That was kind of my attitude. It was very depressing. But you know, it's coming. So you know what? Don't miss stuff like this.
Amen.
Oh, yeah.
Amen.
These kind of opportunities are great.
Yep.
You know, I've always encouraged young people, man, you know, if you can get off work and come to stuff like this, these are great times. Yeah. They're great memories. Yep. There's a lot of great things that you can learn. A lot of things that impacted my life. Decisions I made that impacted my life. I made it. Can't.
Right.
This. And I'm thankful for those. You want to get as much of this kind of thing as you can. Right. You know, that's how I learned how to, you know, a lot of what I learned when it came to running kids programs was from what I watched and stuff like this. You know, you come and you learn new songs, you learn new games, just a lot of fun stuff, ways to be a blessing. You know, there's a lot you can get. You ought to be paying attention. You ought to be trying to learn. You know, every time I visit another church, I'm watching what's going on there. Not because I'm trying to judge a church and critique the church, but I'm just like, you know what? We should do that at our church too. I like this.
Amen.
You know, I'm trying to get ideas. I'm trying to get wisdom. I like talking to other pastors. Hey, you know, how do you do this in your church? How do you run this? You know, I don't think everything in ours is just perfect in the way it all ought to be done. I'm constantly trying to learn and improve things.
Yeah.
That ought to be your attitude in life. You ought to already be paying attention to people that are a few years older than you. And you know what you should be doing with them? All right, watch this. You should be judging them.
Yep.
Okay. Now, not because you're just out there to condemn them, but you know what? Watch them to see what works and what doesn't work.
Right.
Hey, that guy that's doing everything that you want to do, but you've been holding yourself back, watch what happens to him.
Right. Right.
You know, watch that guy who does things right. Watch that guy who's not as cool, but follows the advice of his parents and follows the advice of his pastor. Watch what happens to him. Judge that guy, too.
Yep.
And always be paying attention to these things. I was taught to do that. I was taught to judge growing up.
Yeah. Amen.
I was taught that.
Amen.
My dad taught me to do that. To, you know, look and see what works and what doesn't work.
Right.
And I paid attention to that. And I learned a few things along the way. You know what? I one of the best decisions I ever made as a teenager is that I think I was 13 or 14 years old. And I decided at camp that I was not going to get a girlfriend until I was old enough to get married.
Yeah. Amen.
Now, a lot of people think that's a tough decision right there. That was one of the best decisions I ever could make. And you know why I made that decision? It had nothing to do with the preaching that I heard. It had nothing to do with nobody said anything as far as I remember in the preaching on that. It was like my third year going to a camp, and every year I was seeing these guys that were like missing all the fun
because
they were too busy trying to get with a girl.
Yeah.
And, you know, getting this relationship and then breaking up that week.
Yeah, that's right.
After a four-day relationship,
hey,
they break up. And the guy was devastated.
Yep. Come on,
he had
now.
No fun. And I'm like, you know what? This is stupid.
All right.
I'm at camp. I want to have fun. And I wasn't going to waste my time trying to impress the girls because I knew if we even got together, we were going to break up within a few days.
Hey, man.
And what's the point of that? What's the point? I just learned that from judging. From watching.
Amen.
You ought to do that kind of thing. It'll save you a lot of heartache. I would rather let everybody else suffer.
Amen.
Than me.
Yep.
You know, I'll watch and see what happens to them.
Right.
You know, I've always wondered what it'd be like to, you know, fall from a building or something like that. But I don't need to learn by experience.
Right.
I learn from somebody else's experience.
Amen.
I'm sure there's a video on the internet you can watch of somebody fall from a building.
Amen.
It's like, yep, I'm pretty sure that hurts. I'm pretty sure I'll regret doing that.
Yep.
And let me tell you something. When it comes to the stupidity that's going on with young people today, it seems like it's pretty common, and it always has the same result.
Right.
Yeah.
But yet kids keep doing it.
Yep.
Yeah.
Why is it? You know why? It's because you've been taught not to judge.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Amen.
So there's good judging. There's bad judging. There's good judging.
Yep.
But you've been taught by the world not to judge at all.
Amen.
Yeah.
And so then you just go, it's like, well, wait a minute. I probably shouldn't jump off that building. Everybody else said that it's dead. How dare you judge them?
Yeah.
You can't know that they're dead till you've walked a mile in their shoes, and you just need to do it for yourself, and then you'll know. Yeah. No, I'd rather not do that.
Amen.
You know what? I've seen enough to know that I shouldn't drink alcohol. I don't need it. I don't need to find out what it's all about. I'm sure there's something to it, otherwise everybody wouldn't be trying it.
Yeah.
But I've seen what it does, so you know what? I'm not interested.
Amen. Yeah.
I'm not interested in drugs. I'm not interested in cigarettes.
Yep.
I've known too many people that couldn't get jobs because of these things. And I don't need that. I've got a whole family depending on me. Yeah. And you know what? If I could get anything across to you kids, is just that it's hard when you're young to understand what you're going to need going forward and just the results of some of these choices that you're going to make. And so I can only encourage you to do two things. Is just watch other people. Watch people that are older than you. Learn from their mistakes. Learn from what they do right. And then two, just have the attitude of Moses. That you know what? I want to hang on to everything I've got. Because I don't know what God's going to want from me.
Yeah.
And one of these days, God's going to lay it out there. And he's going to say, all right, this is what I want from you. And you need to make sure you're ready to give him whatever it is he needs. So with that, let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for this beautiful day, Lord, for all these kids that are here. Lord, I pray you'll help them to realize just how important their lives are and how important your will is for their life. And I pray that they will treasure what you have given them, Lord, that they will hang on to it, not for themselves, but they will hang on to it for your sake. And Lord, help them to realize that your way is the best way. It'll make them more happy than anything else in this world.